blessed be the name of the Lord. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Righteous run into, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into.
We love you with the love of the Lord. We had a good weekend. We had baptismal service, and Brother John did a good job again, as always. And we sure appreciate that. And we'll be doing that in the next couple of months. So you got 2 months to sharpen your pencil, and then write it in blood. That's right, right. We appreciate Brother John and the ministry that he has. For that part, so we sure appreciate that. Remember Brother Bob tonight? He's at Brother Stephen Shambo's in North Carolina. That he'll do it. That he's a bit nervous, but that's okay. He'll be all right. I told him, I said, just preach like you normally preach. You ain't got to do anything special, you know. So he's there tonight. We sure appreciate him going off, and good to have Brother Luis and Brother Aaron back. Good to have them back with us. And I think Brother Luis is going to be gone again Sunday, so just keep him in prayer. May the 1st, which will be a week from today, Brother Donaldo. Is he from Honduras? He's from Honduras. He's been here twice, and I really appreciate the brother. Got a good, powerful ministry. He's going to be with us this coming Wednesday, a week from today, on May 1. May 4 will be the Bible study prayer meeting starting at 5 o'clock from 5 to 6, just like we always do here, come and pray. And then 6 to 8, bring your questions, or if there's a subject you want to talk about, just bring that with you. May the 5th will be communion. This Saturday at 4 o'clock, some of us, and some of you know, but we're inviting anybody who wants to go, Dutch Treat, 7466 Highway 17, Hiawassee. We're going to the Deer Lodge. And most of you know where it's at. It's on the Hiawassee Road from Helen, and it's right on the side of the road. And we'll be there at 4 o'clock, right, Brother Danny? 4 o'clock. And wives and anybody wants to go, you can go. We're just going to have a little fellowship and fill the rooms up, and they'll probably be pretty full anyway because that place is really popular. But we're going to congregate there about 4 o'clock. So if you want to go, just show up. And remember, Brother Aaron also is going to be gone this weekend, and Brother Richard and the Roberts family, is going to help the Roberts family move. Well, no, not the Roberts family, the Nicole family, Shepherd family move. There you go. So they're going to be gone this weekend to do that. So remember, too, that May the 11th is Mother's Day. We'll only have one service. Brother Bob will be speaking. Sister June and I are going to Ohio for about 3 days, and we'll be there Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. But Brother Bob will be here. We'll have one morning service, so you can go be with your mother later on in the day. So we sure appreciate Brother Bob doing that for us while we're gone. So we're to be in Ohio there for a little while. And I want to ask you a question. Does anybody have Memorial Day weekend plans? Like, you're going to be gone? You're going to be gone? Well, don't be ashamed. I'm just, if you're going to be gone, please tell me you're going to be gone. I know a lot of times it's an extra day, and people like to go and take holidays. It's fine with me, but we'll talk about something later on about that. Middle of May, because that's it, the last weekend in May. We'll talk about having a real special service, but I would like for everybody to be here. I've been thinking about having a ordination service. There will be some new deacons, there will be some new trustees, and we will have, and myself, Brother Bob, not going to tell you who I'm going to ask to come, but I'm going to see if he'll be able to come and be with us. So just keep that in prayer. Man said one time, said, when we work, we work. When we pray, God works. Amen. When we pray, we work. But when we pray, God does the work. Amen. You love the Lord? Just remember me tonight. I'm leaving about 2 o'clock in the morning, going to Kentucky for a couple of days. We got some new property up there, and we're going to take a look at it and be back Saturday, early Saturday. So just keep me in prayer. And keep Sister June in prayer. May the 21st, she'll be having hip replacement surgery. So just keep her in your prayer. Thank God for doctors. We use them. And I believe the good ones and the good nurses have a space in heaven somewhere that God's going to put them. I do, because they're here to help. If they're real humanitarians, then they're just almost like a minister. They minister to your body, and try to get try to help that part to heal. We know God's the healer, but it takes a little nudge every once in a while for man to push something and take a hip and replace it. But God's got to put all that together. God's got to heal every bit of it. He's got to put them muscles back together. Man can't do that. But we owe a God that does. So we appreciate you. We love you. We love the Lord. Is this thing not on, Josh? Is it not up so we can tap it? I tapped it. Let's bow our heads. We're going to pray for this thing before we get started. To Heavenly Father, thank you for this week service, Lord, in the middle of the week, Father, that we come together and took a little time out, Lord, to come rush from work and wash our face and eat a little bite and come on to church, Father. And I appreciate that. I appreciate each one making an effort. And Lord, now I pray that you would reward that effort with a word from you, Father, that will help them through the rest of the week. And Lord, be something eternal for us to grab a hold of, Father. And I pray for the ones that are not here, Sister Johnny and the different ones, Lord, that are sick. They're not with us, Lord. I pray that you'd be with them and continue to bless them and touch our father and our mother, Lord. Just be with them, Lord, and just be with the ones, Lord, that are on the highways, the ones that are going to be out this coming weekend, Lord, doing their due diligence, Lord, somewhere else. Father, I pray that you'd touch them and be with them. Father, just be with us now in the furtherment of this service in Jesus' name. Amen. See there? Close your eyes and open your eyes. It's on. Don't close your eyes again. May go back off. But we're going to try to slow down a little bit tonight and talk about the four living creatures. We need to insert this in because we're getting to the fourth church age, and then that's when things shift from one creature to a new one. All right. So let's go to Revelation 1, verse 10. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day and heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet, saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book. So God wanted it written. It was written by a prophet. And it was written to seven church ages. And then God gave the inspiration to seven messengers to relay that message to the people in the seven church ages. All right? So he sent, how gracious is our God? I was thinking the other day, how gracious is God that he just laid all this out? Yeah. It's perfect. Everything he does is perfect. We may think it's not sometimes.
Yeah. Right.
But it's perfect. This is the only way he's going to get himself into me and you. And for us to come to a body change, this is the only way to do it.
Right.
Now, I don't mean right here. I'm talking about the plan laid out using apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, and evangelists coming from one messenger, Brother Branham, then through a fivefold ministry, and then back into the bride, and then bring it back this way.
Right.
Just brings it all full circle, right back around, and God's going to come and get himself. He's going to get a bride.
Amen.
Send it to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea. Now, we're in that Laodicean age, so we have all the information of all those other ages. We've got every up and down, every high and low, every personable person that lived during this time. We know who they are. Thank God for a prophet that he could lay them in order, and God could vindicate it on a wall at the tabernacle. An angel come and drew the same thing that Brother Branham had drew. And which was a true vindication that he was, I believe, the seventh star or the seventh messenger. We're not looking for another one. But John turned to see the voice, so he went to turn to see a person. He did see a person, just like we're going to look at these four living creatures. Ezekiel turned and saw four images or four likenesses, and they all were the likeness of a man. And without a revelation, you can't see that. Because there was a lion, ox, man, and eagle, and Ezekiel said they all four had one likeness, like the likeness of a man. We know who that was. That was Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yes.
Same way with John. He turns to see Jesus, and he knew Jesus. He turned to see Jesus. He saw this man standing in the middle of the seven candlesticks and girt about the paps. John was enough of a Jew to know that this was service and this was judgment. All right? So God is standing now in the form of the Son of Man, then in the form of the bride, in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one likened to the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girded about the paps with a golden girdle. You can go ahead and sit down. Lord, that is a blessing to the word. Let's continue reading. Revelation 4, verse 6. I wanted to stop here and talk about these combat beasts because they're very important. If you... Everything God gives us, he gives it for us to use. There's not, see, these things that we do, there's things that we may be writing a book, there's things that we may say, there's things we may get up and say tonight. That's just me. But God doesn't do that. When God moves, it's perfect. When God says, it's perfect. So God doesn't have to redo anything. Y'all with me? So you say, what is the importance of these? Why did he break this into four beasts? Why did he just not say it's the Holy Ghost in every church age? Well, because there's characteristics of that Holy Ghost.
Right.
And characteristics. Well, I don't have the church ages over there, but there are characteristics in each age. I hope you see that. There was a pull and there was a group of people. It's like the plug-in. This is not going to do you any good. Right. You can have an extension cord 800 miles long. But without the power that you plug into, it's not going to do you any good. It doesn't matter if it's the greatest thing ever was. If it doesn't plug in, well, that's the same way with God. He looked down through time and he saw a group of people, and they came in and they were magnetized, as Brother Brown said. They were, in other words, they were vulcanized to that message.
Right.
And they'll come in with their messenger.
Right.
As Brother Branham, they told him, they said, who are these? He said, they're Branhams. No, they're not Branhams. They're your converts.
Right.
And then the angel told him, said, you'll be gathered with these people. So we're identified with that. You'll be gathered with these people. Come back to earth with them.
Right.
He'll be still our leader.
Right.
Everybody with me?
Amen.
I don't have a problem with that.
Because right.
Without him, I'm not getting here
right.
to go there. I'm not getting enough here to go there
right.
without Brother Branham bringing the message. All right?
Amen.
Like I said Sunday, are we sufficiently impressed with what we've got? Are we sufficiently impressed with the books, the tapes, the things we do, the revelation that we get, the technology that we can use now when they didn't have that before?
Right. Amen.
Are we impressed that God give us all this in the end time? And it's the shortest age, but it's the fastest information that we'll ever get. It's almost, what's AI? They're saying AI now is moving closer than it ever has before to being human.
Right.
We know it can't be.
Right.
But it's figured things out so fast. Until you sit in a jet plane now, they don't even have to touch the thing. It drives itself.
Right.
And it corrects mistakes before the pilot even knows it's a mistake. We got a God like that. I want to let you know he's a little bit faster than that one.
Amen.
He's already had it done. All we got to do is grab a hold of it.
Amen.
We get ready to take off. He's already got it ready.
Right.
All right, everybody with me?
Right.
All right, Revelation 4, verse 6. So everything God wrote in the Bible is important. Every piece of this puzzle has to fit together.
Amen.
All right? If it's not, guess what? It's not God. That's what happened in the second church age, and then now in the third church age, we'll look in a minute. Man started pulling the plug out, or either stopping the flues up and getting their own ideas involved.
Right.
We got to get rid of our own ideas.
Amen.
And before the throne, there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. Now, we're going to read this, and then we're going to go to Ezekiel in just a few minutes, but we'll go through the church ages one more time, just for a minute, the first three. Now watch this scene. John is caught up. So John's type of the bride. So it's us looking at this scene. And the scene is a throne, a sea of glass, likened to crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were four beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was what? Like a lion. The second beast, a calf. Now the characteristics of these are what? A lion is bold. A lion roars. A lion's the king of the jungle. When he speaks, people listen. Well, that's what went out in the first church age. When Peter speak, people listen. When Paul spoke, people listen. When Irenaeus spoke, people listen. Because you know what? They didn't have an internet to go back to. They had to listen to that fresh word, and they had to have the Holy Ghost so much in tune with that minister to what they really listened to what they said. And couldn't go back the next day and go, I mean, where's that on YouTube? Let me see what he said.
Right.
Couldn't do that.
Right.
But the Holy Ghost was that lion age. It was that boldness that they came out and said, silver and gold have I not. So I say, are we sufficiently impressed? Listen, when you got a real good ball team, you're impressed.
Amen.
When you got a real good partner in your job, or when you got a real good job, or your success. you're impressed.
Right.
I don't want to impress somebody with what I got. But God has given us everything we need. We should be impressed with what He's given us. Not what the world's given us, what He's given us.
Right.
And then if we can, as Brother John, if we can kind of mold that together a little bit. Well, I'm a Christian. I don't have to pay. Come on, we got to be well-rounded.
Right.
We got to be well-rounded Christians.
Right.
Amen. We can't be above. Faith comes by faith comes by whatever you, if you want to sit home, you're fine. Faith comes by, I don't know. Faith comes by, well, I don't think. Faith comes by hearing. And I don't think there's another scripture that contradicts that. I don't think there's another scripture that contradicts another one anyway, do you?
No.
Okay, so if faith comes by hearing, then we got to hear that.
Right.
All right? Faith is believing for something you can't see. You don't have to have faith. If you see me standing here today, you don't have faith to see me.
Right.
I'm right here.
Right.
But now the time from when we started to getting here, something could have happened.
Right.
But you got to have faith for the journey.
Yep. Amen. That's right.
But you got to be able to see the end of the road. Abraham, Brother Brown said, Abraham went ahead and got the birdies and the boot eyes, which y'all know what that is. That's getting ready for the baby to come. Getting the Pampers you don't know, we used to have to actually put pins in diapers to hold them up on the sides. They wasn't none of this Velcro. Lord Jesus, we was before Velcro. But I remember those little pins, they'd be pink and blue. Hello, somebody. And they'd have a little bird on the end of it. Well, praise the Lord. Let's not get off our subject. The first beast was like a lion. I can see them now. The second, like a calf. And, oh, you know one thing's for sure, that when a baby all of a sudden makes a quick move and starts screaming, you better check and see, because that pin's probably popped out and it's sticking that poor old baby in the side of their rear. But Velcro settled all that, so we're okay. But that's what Brother Brown was talking about. That was his age. They had cloth diapers, they had birdies and boot eye, and they had the booties and all that stuff, getting ready for the baby to be born. Well, that's what we got to do. We've got to see the baby here.
Right.
We got to see the body change already here.
Right.
And falling apart, we still got to see the body change already here. All right? Because He's an unchanging God, the prophet said, with unchanging ways. So whatever way He got this all set up, that's the way we're supposed to come. We can't change it. Man's trying to change it, and that's what we're going to look at. Man changed it in that third church age, and they were thoroughly married. Church and state were married so much together, you couldn't tell the difference. All they took was they took Zeus and Thor and all these different ones. They took them down and put up who? Peter, Paul. All the different ones. They just pulled a quick one on the people there in that third church age. And we'll read it in just a second. But the first beast was like a lion. The second like a calf. What? Ox. Ox, burden bearer. The third beast had a face of a man, which is intelligence. There's nothing wrong with God's intelligence.
Nope.
Don't put ours into it, but there's nothing wrong with the intelligence of God. And when we tap into that intelligence, as Brother Branham said, let's go back in the back part of God's mind. I don't think Brother Branham went back into there, came out and told us, and then he shut.
Right.
I believe it was open.
Right.
Aren't we in the open book?
Amen.
Aren't we in the open book when the seal's open?
Right.
So we can go into the mind of God. We've got to go back in the mind of God just like He did to get a revelation. I just believe that. I don't believe it was all for Brother Branham. There was a lot of things, yes. His office called for different things. But when it come for him to tell us something that we need to perfect us, we go get it just like he did. He called us little what? Messiahs. When are we going to start being impressed with that? He also said that we would be a prophetic people.
Right.
And we would only listen to prophetic utterance.
Right.
And we would love it because we would be prophetic. Well, being prophetic, you got to be in the mind of God.
Right. Amen?
Amen?
Exactly right.
The fourth beast was like a flying eagle. Now, we know that's the age we're in, and we glory in that, but you need all these other ones, too.
Right.
All right? So let's look here in the church ages. I just proved all this. The announcement would come from God, right? Straight from the mind of God. It came out to a group of seven men, all right? Not seven women, seven men. Sorry. I was talking to a guy today about the Methodist Church, and they've just went off the cliff when you stay in the United part. Gays, lesbians, whatever, it doesn't matter. As long as you feel like you're ordained, they'll ordain you. If John Wesley would be here right now, like Brother Brown said about Paul, he'd be in jail before the morning.
Amen.
He would be throwing them out of the churches. But you see, though, listen, it started pure.
Right.
It started pure. There's going to be a Methodist, a method of doing things, as John Wesley was. There's going to be that group there, bride.
That's right.
Bride. In the city, talking to me and you, brethren, sisters, that comes from these ages that we seem like it's all messed up. And we look now, we do see the end of it messed up. But the beginning of that was God. Listen, the Baptists had the Holy Ghost back when he got started. All the different ones, but what happened was, just like we're going to look now, they get thoroughly married to an organization. Or they get thoroughly married to the devil. Listen, it's the truth. They're so confused and so deceived till they're worshiping Satan thinking they're worshiping God. That's what the Bible says. That's how deceived they are. Pray that we don't get in that deception. That we don't worship a man. That we don't worship anything but Jesus Christ. And then that filters down through every one of us. Through a prophet into us. Not the prophet got everything. It's now in a bride. If it's not, we need to just go home. That's why I told that guy. He said, we believe in return ministry. I said, well, close church. Go to the house. Why? Wait on him to get here. When he gets here, tell us what to do. That's baloney. There's a fervor in this message that made people come to church, made people study, made people want the Holy Ghost, made people want to get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, made you want to do what the prophet told us to do, not sit around on your hind end waiting on somebody to come and tell you something different. Oh, you know what? He will come tell you something different, and it won't be the prophet. It'll be the devil himself. Wrapped up in a prophet. He wants to be God. The Bible says he's going to be God in the end time. God of this evil age. So the messenger, thank God, God pulled a messenger out and had him in his hand and said, hey, this is what I want you to preach. And he was so yielded to him until that's what he done. He preached the word of God like had never been preached before. Then that message is a trumpet. We're listening to it now. The world is listening. We were at Sister Kathy's mother's funeral. We were pallbearers, me and Brother Gary and Brother Terrence. And the guy did a good job. He's a nominal guy. He did a really good job. But they're all looking for something coming out there, something out yonder. Right, yes. It's right. Really, I mean, it was wonderful what he said. I appreciate what he said. But it wasn't that... Well, let's get this body changed and let's get this woman out of the ground. You know, we got to do it. No, they just, when Jesus comes, he'll, you know, raise everybody up and we'll come with him. And, well, Jesus is, but he's going to be hidden inside of me and you.
Right.
That's the sufficient impression is that God's going to do it through us.
Amen.
He's not coming back in physical form until the millennium. So anything that happens, wake up. Anything that happens today,
right.
Till the millennium,
right.
Deals with a bride.
Amen.
Not one man anymore.
That's
even
right.
Going to Israel, they're waiting. Look at those people over there.
Right.
They're waiting on us to get out of the way.
Right.
So that God can deal with them. Just like he dealt with you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Thank God for this message.
Amen.
Thank God for this message. One more time, are we sufficiently impressed with what we do have? Are we using it the way we should use it? Are we becoming it?
Come on.
Brother Branham wanted to see a group of people live what he said. And manifest what he said, because when he owned a sixth seal, he said, you're not getting it, it's not for you. Live a good Christian life, it's gone from you.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost had done, not the Holy Ghost had left, but that anointing for them to take a body change had left.
Right.
Because the preaching of that of those seals on those 7 days was for a body change.
Right.
They just, nobody could get it.
Yeah. Right.
So Brother Brown went off the earth with a what? A faith that God was going to have his message get into a group of people, and that group of people was going to carry this thing on to the coming of the Lord.
Right.
Do the best they can with ever what they got. Somebody's going to make it.
Amen.
And it's got to be through this message.
That's right.
Right.
It's a life. This message.
Through this message.
Right.
But there is a false. As Brother Boyd, we were talking back there, he's talking about light. If we're light, if we cast a light, we're not the shadow.
Right.
But what is it? But what is it casting that there is a shadow? But it's not on you. It's out there. The darkness is out there. Well, it's inside of us if we don't get it out of us. But if we're the light, become the light. If we're the light, then remember, it casts a shadow out there. They're in darkness. But we can be in spiritual darkness sitting right here tonight. Caution yourself. I caution all of us.
Amen.
To either get in or get out.
Come on.
Right.
Have a fervor. Say, man, I love this message. I love to hear a message preacher. Oh, yeah, listen. Oh, it's okay. And I do listen to Baptists and Methodists. And I'll listen to, you know, what is the black guy's name, Bodie? Or he's a pretty good guy. But anyway. And you can, but you look at something and you say, well, what is he talking about? So you click on it, like the one that I did the Trinity. He told the Trinity was like Adam and Eve, and his, their children was like the Trinity, three people, you know, on each side. That don't work. But they're having, for whatever they've got, they're having a fervor themselves. They're trying to find something.
That's right.
Amen.
What was the college? Ashbury?
Right.
Do you know that Brother Neville graduated from Ashbury College? Brother Brown said it on one of the tapes I was listening to the other day, or reading. He said, yeah, brother. He said, we got Brother Neville here from Ashbury College. I thought, wow. And they had a revival for, what was it, months.
Yeah.
Packed the place out.
Yeah.
Right.
Look around. We ain't packing places out.
Come on.
Right.
But it's not for everybody.
Right.
We're called to a higher calling.
Right.
We're called to something not different, but something different level.
Right.
So I said, are we sufficiently impressed that we've got the greatest thing that ever hit the face of the earth?
Amen.
Ever has been spoken by man's lips. This
right.
is it.
Amen. That's right.
So the true word will create a false doctrine because there's two opposing forces.
Amen.
There will be a false vine, is a false vine, there is a true vine.
Right.
But Brother Brown said the law of contrast is where you got a true, you got to have a false. Amen? But then that messenger is laid away. It patterns all the way through, so you can't make it that Brother Branham's something that's going to got to come back and finish. Every one of them finished their course.
Right.
Every one.
Right.
Paul, Irene, every one of them finished their course. Brother Branham finished his course. God laid him away, and they're waiting on me and you
right.
to get him out of the ground.
Amen.
By the message that he preached.
Right.
So listen, today people are accepted or rejected. And it brings a judgment. It's what's happening out there. They're spiritually dead. But I caution you one more time. Let's don't be spiritually dead ourselves.
Right.
Because Jesus told them, said, look, if the light in you be darkness, how great is that darkness? If you think what you have is light and it's wrong or false, what a deception. That's like this church age. Blind, rich, and miserable, and what? Naked.
Right.
And don't know it. They think they're fully clothed. They think they've got a name. And I'll read you in the next church age where it says, you got a name that you're living by, you're dead.
Right.
So the next age comes out, next age comes out. Then it comes to the end. And that's where we're at. And it will culminate. I keep pulling this up because there will be another age of Pentecost in our right before our church age starts to pattern the Alpha church to the Omega church. There'll be a age of Pentecost, 1906, and then Brother Branham will bring his message. Is everybody with me? Because he'll even tell you the messenger was the Holy Ghost. That one-eyed black man, he was a spokesman, just like Peter was.
Right.
All right? And then it comes to a place to where then a prophet comes on the scene, and then all that other, because remember, they were Trinitarians.
Right.
They baptized Father, Son, Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost fell on that. It didn't fall on that false doctrine. It fell on the fervor of what they held inside of them that we want truth.
Right.
We want the gifts restored. God didn't take the gifts out. Man took the gifts out.
Right.
If anything's ever taken out, we take it out.
Right.
God keeps it where it's at, and we just got to come back to it. That's why he had to restore us back to the gifts.
Right.
And they're still here.
Amen.
If we'll just use them. So the Alpha Age was the Ephesian church age. We know that Paul was there. He was the church age messenger. Then we know who the great shepherd is. The great shepherd is Jesus Christ, okay?
Right.
All right? He's the head shepherd.
Right.
But he has porters. He has ministers. He has people that even like Moses stood in the gap for his people.
Right.
Brother Bram said he portrayed Christ.
Right.
To stand in the gap for his people. Let me tell you something. Brother Bram stood in the gap for us.
Amen.
None of us would have had a chance if Brother Bram hadn't come and straightened everything out and then give us a grace.
Amen.
We'd be in horrible shape. All of us would be in horrible shape. So thank God he did send us a prophet. But remember, that great prophet always pointed us to the great shepherd, which is Jesus Christ. Every church age messenger never pointed their finger to their self. Ever. Now, many men did. Like Brother Branham made him God, baptized in his name. Oh, that was the devil.
Yeah.
And it upset him so much, he said, I'm coming off the field. This is not what I'm here for.
Right.
I'm just quitting. You know, I believe that angel probably went. Don't you remember that cave? I came and gave you a commission. You need to fulfill that commission. You get back out there and get to work. Remember, because you never did come off the field. I mean, he quit preaching for a few weeks, and then right back on the field he went. Right in the 60s, there where he wanted to be anyway, to bring the seals and the different things that he preached. So let's continue on. We'll get through here in just a little bit. And there's your church ages. So you got all the church ages. And now we're going to look in just a few minutes that the Holy Ghost fell where? On the day of Pentecost, AD 30. Everybody with me? All right. And then it was the Holy Ghost in every single age. All that white you see is the people that got the new birth. Not an anointing, not a false anointing, not a cup of water in my name, not a foolish virgin. That white is the bride.
Yes.
That's people that came through justification, sanctification, baptism of the Holy Ghost, received the new birth in their soul, burn out the old nature, put God inside, there you are.
Right.
All right? But in the first three ages, that was true, and it was held true by those three messengers, Paul, Irenaeus, and Martin. And it was separated because it was the lion. But now you're going to see in just a minute when we get to the Pergamene church age, which Pergamene means thoroughly married. So what happened is there was something got in, that black. See how much the black is? That's false teaching. That's the devil. All right? That's how much he hates the word of God. He wants to squeeze every one of us out. He'd kill us all right now if he could. Every one of us. Without that protection. Thank God.
Amen.
We ain't going until God pulls his hand off of us.
That's right.
Job didn't go until God pulled his hand off of him.
Right.
He should take everything away from him, but you can't touch his body. You can't touch his soul. That's the old mind.
Right.
Praise God.
Amen.
But the Smyrna church age, remember Smyrna means bitter. So actually we see Ephesus. Then we have Smyrna. Smyrna is bitter. What is it bitter? Bitter is coming from death. Bitter's coming from myrrh. Bitter's coming from false doctrine.
Right.
False teaching is becoming more. Listen, it's in the church.
Right.
It's in the church. It's not in the beer joints and the honky tonks. It's in the churches where they taught this, the black part of that. Hello, somebody. Thus we have a twofold significance found in the name of the age. It was a bitter age filled with death. The two vines, now look, within the framework of the church, what did Brother Bam tell us in the end time? We need to find out what the two spirits are in the framework of the message church. Discern who they are. Call them out.
Amen.
The two vines within the framework of the church were drifting further apart with an increased bitterness toward the true vine on part of the false. Now watch. Death was not only the seed of the false vine, but even in the true vine.
Yeah.
Satan had already crept into the true vine and started giving them false teachings, false doctrine.
Right.
And it paralyzed them. You see that? It paralyzed them. Made them impotent. In other words, they could not. If you're impotent, you can't perform. You can't. They didn't make children.
Right.
Everybody with me? Satan was closing that off to where nothing. You can sit in a congregation today and close yourself off.
Right.
All right, let's don't. That's why I said every evil in those ages, as the prophet said, every evil comes right down to here.
Right.
Every good comes right down to here. But every evil, and he said it multiplies more and more and more to where now you can't tell the difference in the two vines.
Right.
Amen.
Exactly.
But let it bear fruit. Let it grow long enough. Jesus said, oh, no, don't cut it down now. Wait just a minute. If the tares will come up, they'll show what they are. Brother John, if it's corn, it'll show what it is.
Right.
If it's wheat, it'll show what it is.
Right.
Then you can cut them down that and burn them, and you can take the wheat to the garner.
Right.
No true believer is any stronger and spiritually healthy and alive than his knowledge of an adherence of the pure word of God. That's what Brother Brown brought us back to. The pure word of God is what we're talking about today.
Amen.
All right. That church age started 170 to 312. The messenger was Irenaeus. What a powerful messenger he was. Remember, he was militant against organization. There wasn't any organized religion back then. But Polycarp was, and all the great things that he did, there was one thing God had against him. Remember, there's one thing God hates, Nicolaitism. Then there's another thing, and I'll show you here in just a second, and that's the doctrine of Balaam. The chief shepherd. But does he hold back the persecution? Does he stem tribulation? He does not. He said, I know your tribulation. Because tribulation, he can't go over his word. The word says tribulation worketh patience. All right? So he couldn't just in one church age go, no, I'm not going to lay any of this. No. He had to be in continuity with the whole Bible. He has to let us go through things. We wouldn't have any testimonies if we didn't.
Right.
What a stumbling block is to so many people is that they want to instantly, and now they're doing it out there in the world. You know, you instantly become a Christian. You get all these, you know, flowers, and you get sent chocolates from the Lord, and you know, you got buckets of money, and you don't have to have no plan. It just falls right in place. No. That's why, because you know what? God doesn't have to protect anybody that's not his children.
Right.
He doesn't have to.
That's right.
He may commit you to death as he did Paul.
Right.
He may commit you to suffering as he did Job.
Right.
That's his prerogative. He is sovereign, but it's all with a purpose.
Man.
What was the purpose with Job? God knew the end of Job.
Right.
Job didn't know the end of Job. But Job could stand one day and say, I know my Redeemer liveth. This is something going on. I've lost everything I got.
Right.
He lost 7 children, all of his cows, all of his mules, house burnt down.
Right.
It was him and his wife sitting on a trash pile.
Yeah.
That was probably his house.
Yeah.
Right.
Scraping boils from top of his head to the bottom of his feet with pottery. He said, though God slay me, yet I'll trust him. Why don't you curse God? See, that was the woman trying to get into the emotion part. Honey, just curse God and die. He said, oh, you speak like a foolish woman. He said, though God slay me, yet I'll trust him.
Amen.
The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Can we say that and be convicted with that? You better think about it before you shake your head. Amen. A little lower, maybe just a.
Amen.
Right, Brother Aaron, tell him, give me a good old amen there, buddy. Amen. Because we're heirs, we have to suffer with him. He suffered, so we suffer. Unless we suffer with him, we can't reign with him. We have to suffer to reign. Because it builds character. We're going to get into a church age that if you just said you were a Christian, you died. It wasn't that they persecuted you. You lost your life.
Right. Amen.
68 million. I'm going to figure out how many that is as far as it's probably the whole of California and maybe the two states, New York and California, put together. Every person was completely wiped off the earth just because they were Christians. That wasn't everybody else. That wasn't plagues, and that wasn't this and that and the other. That was them killing those people because they were Christians. And they thought they were Christians doing the work of God.
Right. Amen.
Wow. But character is a victory, not a gift. A man without character can't reign because power apart from character is satanic. But power with character is fit to rule. Brother Bram stood there that day. His wife had just took her last breath. And the doctor says, hey, you better get over here. I said, your baby's not going to have just a few more minutes. How many of y'all been through that yet? At one time. Within just a little time. He said, I went over to lay hands on my baby. And what did he say? He said, there was a black sheet come down in front of me. He said, God rejected me. So he knew, but he knew one thing. He could have turned away, and he could have said, cursed, whatever, just like Job. But he said, the Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. He said, something inside me rose up. Humanly, we couldn't have stood that. But something inside of him, there was an anchor that held him. And you know, the situation that he got put in was because he didn't do what God said.
Right.
Hello?
Amen.
We suffered. He suffered that persecution because he didn't do what God told him to do.
Right.
That's why when we take communion, that's why the Bible says sometimes we're sick and sickly among you. Many sleep because we don't take communion right. Or we take it with something inside of us that we should not be taking it. Maybe you're not born again yet. Maybe you got something against a brother. Maybe you got something against a sister. Yeah, you better think about it. That's serious business. He wrote it in there for a purpose. That's why we have a recheck every month. We have a recheck. We have a time where we can stop for a minute and pray. God, whatever it is, bring it to my memory. If I need to get rid of it. Or, Lord, you've already covered it for me. I've told it, put it to you, and you've covered it. So I'm going to take communion. All right? Are we sufficiently impressed that that was put in there to keep the church clean?
Right.
Keep us clean. Keeps us checked up. Because power without character. See, Brother Branham was a prophet when he was kneeling in 1930-something before his daughter and his wife.
Yep.
He was a prophet.
Right.
He was born one.
Yep.
He was born again at that time. He was preaching some at that time.
Right.
Everybody with me? I believe he thought what the angel tell him. If you can get the people to believe you, he said, nothing will stand in your way, not even cancer.
Amen.
But he had to right a wrong. He had to right a wrong that he did in his life.
Amen.
You think, boy, that now to look at that, we say, well, that's cruel God. Nope. That put that prophet right where he was supposed to be. But if he would not have character, he had the power. What I'm trying to say, he had the power. He was born again. He was a prophet. Come on. But God let him suffer through that and say, hey, buddy, you're still human. You still make mistakes. Go do what I said. And he went and did what he said. And then, of course, the success was on and on. But you would think, in Brother Brown, he would go and say, man, I just got the power to lay hands on this. And you remember that time he saw the, he come in to pray for that little baby, and he got ready to lay hands on the baby? Oh, come on. Don't think your motive and your attitude, God don't realize what you do.
Amen.
Got ready to lay my hands on him. He said, the angel said, take your dirty hands off that baby.
Yeah.
Dirty hands. Oh, before then, take your dirty hands off that baby. You told a lie. You go make that right. What did Brother Bram do? He didn't say, well, now, bless God, we're going to. No, he said, hang on just a minute. I got something to take care of. He went and took care of it, come back, laid his hands on the baby. The baby got better, right? So don't tell me that the little things we do in our life don't make a difference. That's why I said before about coming in here and just know that you're going to get anointed by the Holy Ghost, knowing that you're going to get rid of all that stuff that you've brought in.
Right. Amen.
Before you come in that door. That door ought to be black on the backside where you leave it all, and then it's white on the inside. Sometimes we don't get what Brother Ram say? One.
Yeah.
Unconfessed sin can make a whole church fail.
Right, right.
One. You know why? Because it permeates.
Amen.
It's like that vine. It's a false vine right here doing this.
Exactly.
Turning right into the true and just intertwining. And say, I'm religious too. I get anointed. Okay. All right, that's enough. The church is not suffering. If the church is not suffering, it's not being tried. It hasn't got it. It isn't of God. So if we got a church that we just, you know, that when you sit down, there's a rose pops up beside you, and it's the sweetest smelling thing you ever smelled in your life, you come to the wrong church. You plop down in a greenhouse somewhere. No, there's probably, when you sit down, there's a thorn there.
Come on.
But we realize that. This is, listen, my whole point is, this is not, should not take us by surprise.
Right. Right.
All the things we go through should not take us by surprise.
Right.
Well, I wonder why this is happening to me. Well, if you're of God, it's for you.
Right.
Right.
Amen.
If it's from God, it's for you.
Right.
To build your character.
Right.
It's very human. Very human to second guess or to wonder why.
Amen.
But you got to go back. Job didn't wonder why.
Nope.
What did Job say? Job said, look, all them three other people, them three other good friends of his.
Yeah.
Now, Job, I think you might got something under the rug here, buddy. You need to come on. You can pay your tithes probably one time or something, you know, something going on. And Job's like, hey, I ain't done nothing. I've done everything God told me to do.
Right.
Remember, Brother Bram said he had a little bit of self-righteousness. Well, at least it was righteous.
Right.
At least he had enough to say, I paid all my tithes.
Right.
I went to church. I've checked the boxes.
Right.
But when you check the boxes, sometimes God wants you to just stand right there.
Amen.
And watch God work, because God worked through Job. Now Job's name will be remembered for an eternity. As the man that went through great sorrow to get great reward. Everybody with me? So there's no way it's free from it. No true believer's free from it. It's the will of God. It's needful. We need the Lord to teach us the truth that we are to suffer and be Christ-like in doing it. Love suffers long and is kind. Now that's still in that lion anointing. All right? So the Pergamene church age, which is number 3, and this will be the last of the lion, L-I-O-N, lion age, because we're going into the ox age, and we'll explain that in just a minute, all right? Just hang with me. Pergamos means thoroughly married. So what happened with just, let's just say courtship between the devil and his subjects has ended up in getting married. Over in the end of the Pergamene church age, and what happens during Pergamos is they're thoroughly married. Church and state marries, and the church becomes rich.
Right.
Right.
But remember, the Bible says rich and increase with goods. But you've got nothing. I saw where the other day where Jeff Bezos was $145 billion with a B. Sister Rebecca, you couldn't even spend the interest off of that in a day. They said that add up to, like, I don't care how, whatever it is, like $470-something thousand an hour that he made. There ain't no human. Well, you know, I mean, he made it. But if he don't get born again, he ain't going to make it.
Right.
All that's going to go away.
Right.
Let me give you a secret. There won't be Amazon in heaven. There'll be an Amazon River. But then you won't have to wait on the packages to get here. Praise the Lord. Won't be no postal service either. Don't start. Pergamos means thoroughly married. Revelation 2, verse 12. To the angel of the church of Pergamos write these things which saith him with a sharp sword with two edges. Listen, God is still trying to get us turned back, to get them turned back to the word of God. But remember, sometimes, I was thinking about this morning. Sometimes, or yesterday, sometimes we think that the Holy Ghost is weak because we see it kind of back up. But remember, thank God for a prophet. He said that the Holy Ghost was timid.
Right.
It was a very timid gentleman.
Right.
So he's not going to pour himself on you or in you unless you ask him.
Right.
He'll just go, all right, dummy. All right, I'll be back in a little while. Right?
Right?
Oh, I'm sorry. I've only went through that. Just pray for me.
No.
How many times you ever thought you didn't have a Holy Ghost?
Yeah.
30 minutes ago?
Yeah.
Hour ago? 5 minutes ago?
Yeah.
But remember, by your fruits, you'll be known.
Right.
That's what I said the other day about a ministry. Watch a ministry. If a ministry is successful, it's of God. It has to be.
Right.
It has to be of God. If it's a true word of God, it's a true minister, God will open a door for any of these ministers, just like he did last Sunday, just like he's doing now. He's opening the door for some of these ministers to go out and preach. But I need some more of y'all so you can stay here, and I won't be so lonely. I'm not going to suck my thumb and go back in the office, okay? But I would like to have somebody here every once in a while that's a preacher in case something happens to me. Well, let's just throw that out for a second. I know thy works, where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou, look, thou holdest fast my name. This is about the last church age to where the Father, Son, Holy Ghost baptism is not taken over. Up till about the second century, as I read you, they baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord Jesus Christ. Now they're getting into Nicaea, where they're getting in to be, as we're going to read later on, there'll be another name that they live by, but they're dead. But it's creeping in. Listen, Satan's a creeper.
Yep.
And he'll creep in where he can. We've got to get those cracks compacted, the Bible says.
Right.
Compacted. Push it all together where Satan can't even get in there anywhere.
Yeah.
Brother Bram said, hold together, word of the church, hold together. He said, Satan will shoot poison in a church. He said, you just bind closer together, and he said, to get rid of it.
Right.
All right? But thou holdest fast my name and hast not denied my faith. Even in those days wherein Antipas, my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. He must have been in church. But I have a few things against you, so the Pergamene church age, because thou hast them that hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now listen, it's come from a deed or a saying to now they're preaching it in the church. It's not doing it underhandedly and doing it in a corner somewhere. They're preaching it in their churches. The doctrine of Balaam and the doctrine of Nicolaitanism. Just, you know, trust the Pope. Trust the priest with your kids. That's what they said, though. Trust us. We're not even going to let you read the book. We'll just write it in Latin and preach it in Latin, and we'll just believe what we said.
Yeah.
Mr. Andy, you heard it in Latin. Did you hear it in Latin?
Yeah.
Okay, I thought you did. All it was, yeah. You know why? They didn't want you to know what they were saying.
That's right.
And there was no power in what they were saying because that was stuff they had formulated, creeds and all that stuff. All right, look, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel? Now, remember, the doctrine of Balaam was what? Balak wanted Balaam to go down and what? Curse Israel. I mean, your prophet, go down there and put some kind of plague on them. Well, remember, God's not a showman. He don't do that. And Balaam was a prophet. Now, he may have been a false one, but he was a prophet. He said, I can only do what the Lord tells me to do. Praise God with that. But remember, though, Balaam was smart enough to where he to get his money's worth. He said, well, I can't curse them. But I know God hates this group over here, the Amalekites and all the different ones. And he told Israel not to marry anybody but in their own group.
Right.
Don't marry an unbeliever.
Amen.
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 So what did Balaam get to do? He turned their head to look at them pretty women out in the world or in his church, and they married. And when they married, God said, can't bless you no more because you've done something I told you not to do. So that was what was happening in those church ages. Those priests were standing there anointed by the devil, preachers anointed by the devil, and they may even known. I don't have a problem with this. But Brother Brown said the Holy Ghost tried to come on Augustine of Hippo and he wouldn't let it. You see how timid that Holy Ghost is, though?
Right.
He tried to come on St. Augustine.
Yeah.
And Brother Brown said he rejected it. Why did he reject it? Why did he reject it? It wasn't what he was believing in.
Right.
Right. If it was what he was believing in, he'd have accepted it. Because I believe the Holy Ghost came and gave him an anointing to keep preaching in the name of the Lord Jesus, to keep out that false doctrine of Trinitarianism, and to save his face, like Balaam, to save his name, to save his position. He said, no, I still got to go with these people. Until the Holy Ghost just said, took his flight. Please don't let that happen to us. Please don't let that happen to us. But he cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel to eat things, sacrifice to idols, and commit fornication. Commit fornication, what did they do? They went and married outside of their being a Jew or an Israelite.
Right.
So Balaam didn't have to really do anything. He didn't go down there and preach. He just said, hey, look at these women. Hey, look at these men. And got them intermingling and intermarried, and then what? He tore the whole place up. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine. Now, remember, it was a deed. Now it's a doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which things I hate. Repent. Now, watch. God gives them a place to repent. Repent.
Right.
Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and that white stone a new name written, which no man knows, save he that received it. So don't worry about new names. Brother Brown said your new name when you got born again was Christian.
Right.
You got a new name, Mrs. Jesus Christ.
Right.
You lost your name, you took on his name. That's good enough for me.
Amen.
If they want to give me another one somewhere else, listen, y'all know who we are. We'll know each other. We're not going to have to get to re-know each other, re-know each other when we get our glorified bodies.
Amen.
We're not going to have to think, I saw you. There ain't going to be none of that. Praise God. There won't be none of that.
Amen.
What was that I was, what did I just say?
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord, for what I just forgot that I was supposed to remember. But that's why that we can't fathom what we're going to. We can't fathom it. You know, you look at people, look at my dad, you know, sharp as a whip. And now, but that's the fall. That's the effects of the fall. Praise God, we had a prophet tell us that has nothing to do with the inside guy. But look how prevalent that your body is and your spirit is over your soul. Do you see that? That it can take over so much and encapsulate that thing to where it just, you lose your mind. And we're losing ours too, regardless of how, what age we are. We're all turning to mush.
Yeah.
Well, the young ones are going, well, oh, really? And us older ones are going to say, yeah. I was hurting somewhere today, and I thought, 4 years, 2 years ago, I didn't feel that. I got hit by a tree the other day and almost knocked me off a lawnmower, and I about died for 2 days. Well, maybe wake you up a little bit. On a lawnmower, cutting my grass. I hit a limb with my head. I didn't duck fast enough. Thank you. Bless me. Thank you, sister. Whatever your name is. But I told Jim the next day, I'm like, why am I? Well, I know why. That thing hit me in the head, and I was sore all the way down. But that's the effects of the fall. When you was a young, you took a young kid, and you could almost throw them out of a tree. And it don't hurt them. Do us that way, and you won't see us for a little while. But that Pergamian age was an important age because it was kind of the hinge point. Get back on my point here. The hinge point between the true bride heading into the falls. Because that dark age is 1,500 years. That one dark age, we'll look at it in a minute. That dark age was, no, we won't. We'll do it next Sunday. That dark age was longer than really the first three ages put together. And it was dark ages because of they did have a real plague. There was a real plague in during that time. But the plague was darkness of spirituality to where they killed Christians, throw them into lions, tie them up to ropes, and let hogs and different things rip them apart right there while they're still alive. Just because they said they were Christians. So this age lasted from 312 to 606. Now remember, they started having councils in Nicaea. Nicaea, Rome, 325 A.D., and the different ones going up to, they had several different ones during the 312 to 606. And every time they met, they brought in a false doctrine.
Right.
Satan was just taking over the whole thing. Because he was coming to that place. Listen, they were so thoroughly married, they couldn't get unmarried.
Right.
They were so twined together, Brother John, they couldn't. Even Brother Ram said that the true bride went to Nicaea to try to pull them out of there. And they even got stuck in it. It's so intertwined. The messenger was Martin. He was very powerful. One time Martin wanted to see, I think I told you, but I'll tell you again, he wanted to see a magistrate or he wanted to see the judge. And the judge said, no, I tell him I can't talk to him. So Martin comes back a little bit later and he says, I need to talk to the magistrate or the judge in the city. And of course the little minions below him said, no, you can't see him. He said, no. He said, St. Martin just kind of stood at the door, and he waited for a second, and he, all of a sudden a fireball comes out and strikes that guy right on his rear end in his seat, and he jumps up out of the seat, and he sees Martin. Where'd that fireball come from? But you know what? That's God honoring what a saint, what a church age messenger.
That's right.
Signs and wonders and different things that he did. So the messenger was St. Martin. He knows where Satan's seat is and where Satan dwelleth. This is two times he said that in this Pergamian church age because it's coming together. Then the thing he has against, remember, there's two doctrines God hates. And he hates Nicolaitanism and he hates the doctrine of Balaam, which lets you dabble with the world. If I didn't make that plain enough, Balaam got them dabbling with the world. Turned their eyes off of the Lord. Turn their eyes off of Jehovah. Turn their eyes off of the ark.
Right.
And turned it right to the world.
Yeah.
And God hates that. So the church and state united during this time. He said, repent, or else I will come and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. There was a group of people. Praise God, in every age there was a group of people that stood against all this false that we're looking at today. Every age had the true believer in it. Somebody that really held on to the message that was given in their hour. And like I said, they had to hold on it. They had to hold on to it and didn't have to go back and watch YouTube to find out what they missed or what they slept through. Now, Brother Brown, I'll just make a comment here, what he said about the stone. There's been a doctrine for years, and I remember it even when I was a little kid, that about the Brother Brown having to come back and give us that name. It's always something coming back.
Right.
I want Jesus to come back. I ain't worried about no other man. I want Jesus himself. He's the only man that saved me. Let me get on my stove for a minute. He's the only one that saved me. He's the only one that heals me. He's the only one that's going to change me. He's the only one that's going to take me to heaven. And if I have to go by the grave, he's the only one that's going to get me out.
That's right.
But it'll be done through a bride. We know where God is. He's in his people. Thank God he was in one person, Jesus Christ. But thank God he said, I'll leave, but I'm coming back.
Amen.
I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you.
Amen.
I'll never put no more on you than you can take. Boy, sometimes we think Brother Johnny gets on that borderline. But you know what he's doing? He's telling you, hey, I built you. You can take more. I built you. You can take more. But now nobody's going to go pour it on, Lord. No. Okay, Lord. But watch this. They got new names in the Old Testament, in the New Testament. Peter, Paul. These names either brought about a change or was given because of a change. Abram and Sarai was changed to Abraham and Sarah. Then they had the child. In Jacob's case, he had to overcome. And then he was called a prince. Remember, Jacob's name had to be turned to Israel. Because Jacob was a shyster. But he was turned to Israel, a prince with God. One of the cornerstones, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph. And today, each one of us true believers has had a change in name. We are Christians. It is not a name common to all of us. But one day we will have another change. We will of a certainty receive a new name. It could well be that name was our true name and original name written in the Lamb's Book of Life from the foundation of the world. He knows the name, but we do not. All right, who's he? Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But we do not. One day at his good pleasure, we will know also.
Amen.
So don't worry about it. We've all been changed. We were non-Christians. Now we're Christians. We were married to the devil. And if you're born again tonight, there was a death.
Amen.
That old husband died so you could marry Christ.
Amen.
Pretty plain and simple.
Amen.
Brother Brown said, look, we have two churches bearing the same name. Donnie, I'm not gonna get to the four beasts. Sorry about that. We have two churches bearing the same name, but with a bitter difference between them. One has departed from the truth. Married idols and has no life in her.
Amen.
She has hybridized herself and the signs of death, not life, follow in her wake. She is powerful with many members. Same way today. Man, those mega churches, 8,000-10,000 people at one time, and then you got like three services, and how do they do that? How do they do that? You know why? Because it's a show.
Yeah.
It's a circus.
Right.
It's a draw.
Right.
Satan loves worship. They don't have to preach. They just worship.
Amen.
Like Joel Osteen. As long as you don't preach on sin, you can have 15,000 people in your church.
Yeah.
I hope he's listening to this. He's not, because they don't care about what we say. She is favored by the world.
Right.
The other is a little persecuted group, but she follows the word, and the signs follow her. The sick are healed, the dead are raised. She's alive with the life and the word of God. She loves not her life, but holds to his name, his faith, even until death. And now remember what happened to Constantine. He had this vision. There seemed to be two reasons why this freedom was granted. The first place, various good emperors had not allowed persecution, but as they passed on, they were followed by those who killed the Christians. So it looks like Constantine's doing a good job because these people, the rulers, are killing them. And he said, no, I don't want to do that anymore.
Right.
See, it was the devil being shrewd in his own house.
Right.
Amen.
There seemed to be two reasons why this freedom was granted. All right, but they passed on. It was so senseless that it finally came to public heed that the Christians ought to be left alone. Now, see, that's only temporary. Hold on, because in a few years, they're going to go right back to killing them.
That's right.
But the problem is here, state didn't have power to do it.
Right.
at this point before Constantine. But when Constantine married state and the church together, they had the army power behind them. And they put them crosses on their back. You'll see right here. The second best noted reason is that Constantine had a very difficult battle ahead of him in taking over the control of the empire. One night in a dream, he saw a white cross appear before him. He felt that this was an omen unto him, that if the Christians prayed for a victory for him, he would win the battle. Now watch how shrewd the devil is. He promised freedom for them in the event that he was victorious. He was victorious, and the freedom of worship was granted in the Edict of Nantes, 312 A.D. But this freedom from persecution and death was not as monogamous as first appeared. Constantine was now, in other words, the head guy.
Right.
He had them both together. As a patron, his interest was somewhat more than that of an observer, for he decided that the church needed his help. No, they did not in her affairs. He had seen them disagreeing over various matters, one of which involved Arius, Bishop of Alexander, who taught his adherents that Jesus, now watch, was not truly God but a lesser being. That doctrine had already, and it's in the message now, today, having been created by God. The Western church held the opposite view, believing that Jesus was the very essence of God, and as they said, co-equal with the Father. With such matters, along with the intrusion of pagan ceremony into worship, the emperor called for a Nicene Council in 325 A.D. with the thought that he would bring all groups together where they could iron out their differences. No, Satan was putting them together.
Amen.
And come to a common understanding and all be one.
Right.
We know that didn't turn out.
Right.
Isn't it peculiar that though this started with Constantine, it didn't die, but it's very much alive today as the World Council of Churches. And where he failed to truly achieve it, it will be achieved on this day through the ecumenical move.
Right.
Constantine started it, put everything together, and guess what? That's what the devil wanted. He wanted church and state to come together. He wanted to have a little bit of money over here and power over the people over here. And when he brought them together, then you got Constantine. Oh, yeah, Constantine won the battle. He gave the Christians a little bit of reprieve, but we're fixing to head into a church age to where they killed 68 million of them. That group from Constantine, that group that he headed up. Now, he might have died and went on, but his doctrine stayed there, and they killed 68 million Christians in 1,500 years of dark ages. And the Catholic Church says they did it.
Right.
They said they did it.
Right.
Fox's Book of Martyrs, you ought to read it. Read some of it. You don't have to read all of it, but read some of it.
Amen.
What they did to the people. True. You not believing in the crucifix or believing in three gods or believing in whatever they believe, then you were just killed. That was it. You know, sometimes we can have a little disagreement. We have a little doctrinal issues. We don't go to the arena with lions. They did.
Amen.
They did. If you opposed what they said, you went to the lion's den.
Yep.
Amen.
Real quick, let's look right here just for a second, and we'll come back and cover this Sunday real slow Sunday morning, okay? Is that all right, Brother Donnie? Okay. All right. I told him we'd get to it, but sorry. Now, here's Ezekiel. Now, I looked and beheld a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, and fire enfolded itself, and the brightness was about it. And out of the midst there was the color of amber out of the midst of the fire. So you're looking at about the same scene that they looked at in the book of Revelations.
Right.
Remember, this is Ezekiel's revelation, though. Ezekiel had not seen Jesus. Ezekiel didn't know who the Messiah was.
Right.
That's right.
He thought he was in the ark. Right? But when we look in Revelations, when John sees them, he sees them as living creatures. He sees them as four beasts, elders, and about the same scene, but he knows that Jesus Christ is that wheel that was in the middle of the wheel.
Right.
So also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of four living creatures. So it was four, not four dead creatures, four living creatures. And this was their appearance. Look, this was there. Got to have a revelation.
Yeah, right.
All right, I can tell you then what he saw.
Right.
All right, Because he came, because look, out of the mist. Now watch, look at me. Out of the mist come four, the likeness of four living creatures. One, two, three, four. But as this was their appearance, they had the likeness of a man. So somewhere in there, the man was the prevalent one, and each one of these were around him. Just like what John saw. The Son of Man was the prevalent one, right? But what was around him? The seven stars, the seven candlesticks. What? The Holy Ghost and the bride. Because remember, where's the ark now? The ark's in you. Those four beasts are your protection. They're the bride's protection. It's the Holy Ghost that you use every day.
Right.
You can speak bold because you know what you're talking about.
Amen.
You can be like an ox and have patience with somebody.
Right.
You can have the intelligence of a man to not get trapped, to not get caught in Satan's, whatever you want to say, false doctrine or what a conversation goes on. God will give you grace if you'll just hang on a minute. Let them say what they're going to say. And then let the Lord lead you. There was a group of people one time wanting me to explain something. And there was one guy that I thought should have known how to explain it. But you got to know. And I'm not being any way saying that I was better than that guy, but that guy should have been able to do it. Being in the message as long as he had been in, he should have been able to do it. He should have been able to tell those people exactly 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, answered every one of those questions. But I answered them all five of them. He said, "See there? See there? You ought to be able to tell somebody the hope that you got." We've been in the message long enough to not have to call the pastor to tell somebody about one God.
Right.
I'm sorry. Amen. Our water baptism.
Right.
You should be able to do it yourself.
Right.
Do it yourself.
Right.
Tell the people the hope that lies inside of you.
Right.
Be the lion. Be bold. If you got the goods.
Right.
If you don't got the lion, you get eat up by the lion. But if you are the lion, there's no beast can eat you.
Right.
No weapon formed can stand against you.
Amen.
Everyone had four faces. We'll close right here. We'll stop. Now look, and their feet. So they had feet. There's that likeness of the man coming out again. And the sole of their feet was like the sole of a calf's feet. Now watch it. They sparkled like the color of burnished brass. What is brass? Judgment. Feet like flames of fire, eyes like flames of fire, feet like brass. John saw the same thing.
Right.
But John had an updated revelation. I like what Brother Ernie said. We've got an updated revelation of what's going on here. And they had the hands of a man under their wing on their four sides. And they four had their faces and their wings. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went everyone straight forward.
Right.
You can't do that without a revelation.
Right.
And you can't do that without God. Because
right.
If you got lion, ox, man, and eagle, and you got them in four, you know, like a square, somebody's going backwards when the other ones are going forward.
That's right.
But you got to see what God's talking about.
Right.
He's talking about whatever you need becomes prevalent right there.
Right.
Whatever you need. If you need the boldness of a lion, he's right there.
Right.
The ox is not backing up. The ox is right there to what? To bear with somebody.
That's right.
The intelligence of man, when to say the right thing, to give the right quotes, or to give the right scripture, or to give the right testimony.
Right.
And then the flying eagle to be to where that it's a revelation that they can draw from and they can see it in you.
Right.
That's the whole thing. I want you to see revelation in each other. Because we love revelation. That makes us love each other.
Right.
I said it makes us love each other.
That's
why it's good to talk about the Lord. It's good to talk about revelation. It's good for somebody to meet Sister Rebecca to say, "Hey, I never seen that before.
Right.
Ain't nothing wrong. Hey, that stuff I ain't never seen either."
Right.
That's right.
Remember Daddy telling y'all that one time? He said, I heard somebody preaching. He said, smart as I am, I never thought of that. So there is a revelation in there somewhere that we can get that we previously did not have. But that's the way I want us to draw off each other. The lion, ox, a man, and eagle. You have the Holy Ghost. You know how they act. You can, come on, musicians. You can identify everybody in this room, even the children, knows what a lion is. Right? And you know what his characteristic is. If you show a picture of it or hear one roar, they say, even a small kid, even Maya, different ones say, oh, that's a lion. Or no, that's a cow. Or, that's a horse. That's a donkey. But they know when that lion roars, they say, oh, that's a lion. Everybody knows what an ox is. Or a mule. They don't go fast. But I'll guarantee you they can pull this building down if you put enough of them together.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then the shrewdness of man to not get out of something. Don't ever use your intelligence to get out of something. Use your intelligence and know how to go back to Scripture and go back to the prophet's message or go back to your brother and sister and say, hey, I need some help. Mm-hmm. That's the shrewdness of man. And then the eagle, there we go back to that eagle anointed where we're up here. Amen. We're little eaglets. When Brother Branham always made a statement, let's stand on our feet. When Brother Branham always made a statement about something, he always included the bride. Is everybody with me on that? Well, the Messiah, well, your Messiah is. Well, there's been a prophet in the land. But now, oh, you have prophetic utterance. There's a powerful message here today, brothers and sisters. But you're not getting it. It's for another group of people. It's for us. And then we know what the eagle does. He comes up to the eagle and he says, oh, you're a bunch of eaglets. He never separated and said, I'm this great something up here. Never did he do that. So you know why? He had character. The power that man had without character, he would have wreaked havoc in this world.
Amen.
Because he was a prophet.
Right.
What he said usually come to pass. But he had enough. Remember? Remember when the two were making love in the sanctuary? If y'all don't know these things, you ought to go listen to tape.
Yeah.
It's been on tape for 60 years now, 70.
Amen.
There's a man and a woman, or a boy and a girl, making love up in the... I don't think they were literally, but they were disrupting the service by hugging and kissing and doing all the stuff that they should not have done. And Brother Brown told them to stop two times. The third time, the Holy Spirit said, whatever you say, that's what will happen. Whatever you say, he said, they could have packed them both out dead.
Amen.
But what did the prophet say? Because he had character. He said, I forgive you. Now stop.
Amen.
I forgive you. He could have passed judgment. What would we have done? I'll just leave you with that. What would you have done? Let's sing a song. We'll talk a little more Sunday. And remember about Saturday, going to eat. So let's sing a song. Let's worship just a minute.
Find my soul. Now as I face life's dark troubled sea, I want the Lord to be satisfied with me. I want my Lord to be satisfied with me. I want my Lord to be what He'd have me be. Then when I reach that great eternity, His smile will say He is satisfied with me. I'm satisfied with God's great redemption plan. I'm satisfied it's sufficient for all men. I'm satisfied with His work on Calvary. But is my Lord satisfied with me? I want my Lord to eternity. His smile will say he is satisfied with me. Lord, give me strength, give me courage, make me bold, that I might lead some lost sheep into the fold, that I might stand unafraid as the focus of the light. Can you stand unmoved, fully satisfied with me? Sing it to him. I want my Lord to be satisfied with me. I want my life to be what he'd have it be. Then when I come to that great eternity, thank God. God's going to smile at you and say he's satisfied.
He is satisfied with me.
Let's sing it one more time. I want my Lord to be satisfied with me. How does he do that? Get in the Word of God. Do what the Word says. Have to be. Then when I come to that great eternity, his smile will say he is satisfied with me.
The Bible tells us that he'll say, well done, my good and faithful servant.
Amen.
You sisters too. He said, well done. You did good. You did what I asked you to do. I know you got persecuted. I know you got belittled by the world. I know they called you old grandma. I know they said y'all were just old fashioned and why you don't wear a makeup? Why you don't the world don't understand. They just don't understand that you don't open your cabinet up and you got, you know, $2,000 worth of Maybelline in. Thank God we don't have to deal with that. Natural beauty is always the best. It's always the best. And we sure appreciate you sisters taking that stand that you do. Us brothers, we're just ugly and we keep our hair trimmed and cut okay and all that stuff and don't have earrings and tattoos and all that. But you sisters shine. And you being a type of the bride, then we all shine. And as we come to the end of the service, I want to ask you to pray. Pray about the things, the meetings coming up. Pray about our brothers going to different places preaching to help the bride of Jesus Christ, to help them, and then come back and give us a good report about that. We sure appreciate it. It's all in the working of God. Every bit of it is. And we just appreciate you and what you do. So let's bow our heads and just remember as we leave here in a few hours and head out for about a 7-hour drive, but that's okay. And we'll be back Saturday to be able to go with them to the... And please, if you would like to come, please come and enjoy a steak with us or chicken. I'll promise you, you will not go away from that place hungry. If you do, your plate's failing the floor because that plate's about... The food's as big as the plate is. So I just pray that's an omen to what's going to happen Sunday. That when we come to church, our plate's going to be so full of food till it's going to overflow. And it just, look, overflow into somebody else. Get in somebody else's plate. I don't know about that. Let's not say anything about that. No, I don't think I would probably, but nobody else would. But God bless you. We love you with the love of the Lord. We'll see you, Lord willing, Saturday or Sunday. Regular normal services this coming Saturday. But Luis will be gone to Virginia. That special meetings up there. Let's pray for them that they'll have good meetings and have good weather. While they have that great big 10 out in the middle of that field. So let's bow our heads. Lord, thank you so much for today. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your people that have come to listen to you, Father, in your word, being spoken through lips, Lord, of unworthy clay. But Father, you chose this. You chose this way, and Lord, I thank you that every minister and every person that takes the word of God and opens the Bible and begins to speak your message, Father, I pray that you'd anoint them all over the world, all over the different places, the many ministers that we know that preach the word of God, that you'll touch them, Lord, and be with them. We think of Brother Keith Reed, Brother George Quinn, different ones, Lord. And we think of the ones that's passed on, Brother Royale, and different ones that just poured their heart out. And, Lord, they've come to their reward, some of them, Father, but we have not yet. Lord, let us completely draw the sword, Lord, and take it to the enemy. Father, forgive us of our faults and failures and our many mistakes, Lord. Be with your bride, Lord. Be with the church here, Father, and bless each one. We come back together in you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. The Lord.